physical law and interpretation.
So he visited China last year. There were three teachers from here. The trip was arranged by.
So this is relationship.
The world is not very big.
Namaste. My name is Lakshmi Sarkota. I'm teaching here in Kathmandu School of Law, and I'm working as a coordinator of BA-LLB first year student. We have a 5 years BA-LLB course in Kathmandu School of Law, and I'm the coordinator of first year. In first year, there are 110 students.
Wow.
Thank you.
The visit to China?
In Renmin.
Namaste. This is Lakshmi Mahathir. I'm going to pass out LLB for
these
scholars, and the same
it
is in faculty.
I'm coordinator of BA-LLB fourth year, and 2 years back I was the professor based in China.
Hello everyone, my name is Gaurav, and by training I'm an anthropologist, and I'm also a researcher. I've published several articles in very scientific journals, and I'm also a columnist in a popular news daily here called Republica.
So you're busy, huh? You're having a busy time.
Yeah, we mix up sociology, anthropology, management, and law. So in the first year, like most of the students have to go through sociology, history, management, political science. And from third year, they start rigorously taking law course.
Hello, I'm here since 2007. All of you are welcome. Thank you.
Very good morning. Namaste. I'm Geeta Patel. So, you can call me Geeta Andhi. I'm a faculty here from the very beginning of this college. And I look after international programs. I have been to China, based in Renmin University, and for the JESSEC. I teach human rights, basically, socioeconomic rights and women's rights. Yeah, you're welcome.
We have a collaborator, Jamaza, Mahidol, and Philippine Antonio Law School and Sydney University Law School.
Oh.
So this course is for 1 year. One semester in Thailand,
mm-hmm.
Next semester in this 5 university. So we have right now 7 students from South Asia.
Mm-hmm.
Geeta looks after basically that program called Master Degree in Human Rights and Democratization. It's a collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very good program.
Mm-hmm.
School of Law, and I did my LLM Masters from Duke University in the US, and I returned back again back to Nepal, and I'm teaching environment law here in the fourth year. And also, I'm working with the Minister of Population and Environment in National Adaptation Plan for Minnesota Process, besides teaching environment law here.
I did my BA-LLB from Kathmandu School of Law, and I'm currently working on a research project in International Relations at Law and Relations Study Center, which will yield a handbook on transit procedures between India, China, and Nepal.
Hello, myself, Britant Khanat. It's going to be difficult to pronounce. B-R-I-T-A-N-T. Britant Khanat, I am a program officer at the center, International Law and Relations Study Center. Whereabout we encourage students to get into research into international issues like humanitarian law. We coach students for various international programs like Jean Picté, JESSEC, and those kind of issues generally. but to be more precise, I am a teaching assistant to Geeta Madam over here in international human rights law and public international law. And generally, I am indulged in research and other activities.
That center also looks after many competitions in international law. So this year we were selected. We were the champion for the region and humanitarian law.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had been selected to go to Hong Kong for the Asia-Pacific competition, and we were fourth. We could not be champion, but we got the. We were defeated by Sydney University, but we defeated New Zealand University. Another environmental law court competition. So we were champion in Asia. So now they have gone to, they're going to Florida for United States for the final round.
In sociology, and in KSL, I look after academic administration.
She is the chief of the academic affairs, so she looks after administration.
就是你书还是挺多的，我看。我是大四的学生，然后受外交部选派在这边学习八个月的尼泊尔语，现在已经度过了七个月的时光了，快要回去接受回收考试了。今天很高兴认识大家。是第一批的吗？以前还有吗？
I think she will also work in embassy in future.
Chen Xiaochen from Chongyang Institute for Financial Studies at the main university in China is a university with a think tank, and we are especially we focus on our studies on global economic governance as well as China's Belt and Road Initiative, or better known here as One Belt One Road. My honor to be here. Thanks. Namaste.
My name is Fan Lei, and I come from the Chahar Institute. Chahar Institute is a non-governmental think tank on diplomatic and the international studies. Now it's focused on the public diplomacy and peace studies. Founded in 2009 by Dr. Han Fangming. Dr. Han Fangming is the vice chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee of CPPCC.
Good morning. My name is Lan Jianxue. I'm with a think tank based in Beijing, China Institute of Internet Studies. I'm a research fellow there. I focus on Southeast Asia. It's an honor to visit Kathmandu School of Law. Thank you.
You also work in the embassy in India before.
Okay. So you know better India.
Namaste. My name is Liu Zhijie, counselor from Asian Department. Minister of Foreign Affairs. Nice to meet you.
Pleasure. It's your name. Similar name as our Foreign Minister Wang Yi.
Yeah.
Run away. That's only easy to remember. I'm professor of the School of International Studies, Renmin University of China. Also a senior research fellow of the both Chongyang Institute for Financial Studies and Chahar. So that reason we have many connections with the think tanks. I used to work in the Chinese mission to the European Union in Brussels, 2008 to 2011. My former major was environmental engineering.
Okay, great.
So I learned environmental law more from you.
Yeah, so it's common to talk about.
Yeah, apparently. So now I research on Belt and Road Initiative. I give my book to your dean, and then we can share more on that topic, and also my Chinese foreign relations. Now I try to work more to learn more from Nepal, and then China-Nepalese relations, maybe in the future, so also interest. Thank you.
I'm Yuvraj Singhala. Namaste. I work for the both government and university. This is my 31 years in university. But in 2009 and 2010, I was working for the Home Ministry as a advisor to the Home Ministry. So my role that time was to reform the security agencies in Nepal. So extensively worked for 2 years. I didn't come to teach here. And in 2012, I was the attorney general. That is, in China, called the People's Procuratorate. So then I came back because I am never insatiated from teaching. So I'm hungry of teaching. So I did 6 hours even these days. And we have this institute, is a government university law college, but it's only premier law college in Nepal. So we are the first recognized by the government. So most of the judges, senior government officers come here to be educated in the master degree. So we have even senior judges to come and do their master degree. We still have not introduced PhD because we still don't have adequate professors to guide them. But we have 6 professors, so about 10 associate professor and assistant professors. So we have 2 type of teachers. We have about 25 teachers there full time. They work from morning to evening. They have to stay here and they have to do research. And another type of teachers are, they work in government, they also practice, so they come to teach a couple of hours every day. We have two journals. So one is called Kathmandu School of Law Review. Another is Kathmandu School of Student Review. So they have been
edited by very senior professors. And this is a peer review journal. We published the journal, giving it for review to senior professors.
Any Chinese scholars?
We have in the board. Mm-hmm. We have in the board, like the editorial board is from law schools, Brandon, Professor Zhu Wenqi. I think he worked for a long time in foreign, we discussed, but again, some challenges that we discussed in that program also, like how to convince China, India, again is the problem. Mm-hmm. We know that India knows it, this is not a bad initiative, this is a very positive initiative. Mm-hmm. But if you see Nepal-India relation for last 70 years, especially for the last 20 years, India want Nepal exclusively within its security zone. It's a Indian undeclared kind of goal. So what probably India is concerned mainly, we discuss it like with this project, Nepal and China may have a very good relation, and Nepal will emerge like a little bit off, so that maybe Nepal may not be always listening to India for its vested interest. So that's a kind of fear. But we believe, as an intellectual and thinking, what we believe here is that it's not, I mean, every country has concern, definitely. Like India definitely has a right to see Nepal support it more than China. Probably India wants us, and maybe it is valid interest that we break the relation of balance between China and India, and we go closer to it. It is its interest, but it's our idea. We should be able to make ourselves balance and to assert our sovereign equal rights that we did in the past. So that's my approach is therefore a little bit different. And this is cool, like all of us, we believe that way. Like, it is the role of think tank in Nepal, intellectuals, students, faculty, journalists, everyone, to convince India that we're not going to go against you, because having good relation with China means not only benefit to Nepal, but also benefit to India. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we can be a kind of bridge between two countries, one. The other is if we are happy, and if we don't have any concerns to you in China, we are friends of, we care of your security, like we take very good care of the security of China in our border. So that's what we need to say. But what, to be very frank and very critical, what think tank in Nepal very seriously failing is, like we always talk traditional things, like China, India, all these kind of things. We have to go a little far. We have to go far.
Well, school or center, you said, be the from the law, from the legal perspective or other. I think it's very important. I visit many other countries, they have their OBOR Foundation Research Center. So far in Nepal, not now. Like the Czech Republic, they are the chief advisor of the president, also the president of the not just introduce OBOR, but I think the synergy strategies, not only with the Czech Republic, also with the 16 plus 1, with the 16 Central Eastern European countries with the OBOR. What we think about from the military perspective, like a Guadalcanal port, I think about to use, because we had the 1962 border conflict with India. During that time, Prime Minister with Soviet Union. And then India seemed this opportunity to move beyond the territory. And then we have to, return back of their territory. I mean, return all the, even we defeated them, but return all the soldiers and the equipment to India. And the Indians think about their lose their face. They will always remember all that. So that's the reason. The only Chinese like to visit Ramani, but not a mutual connectivity. Mm-hmm. So So Belt and Road Initiative, if you one concept is mutual connectivity. Because in the former time, connectivity is you connected with your former colonial power or with European, you know, powers, like in Africans. But your neighbors don't have so many mutual connectivities through the air, internet, road or railway. So now Belt and Road Initiative is for the South-South corporations to help the landlocked countries access to the sea, help the LDC or less developed countries to join globalization, industrialization. Why China should do this? Because we have, to be frankly, we have an overcapacity problem. You know, like a steel, 51% of the world steel, made in China. Later I will show you the high-speed railway, fantastic. 10 years we built 20,000 kilometers of the high-speed railway, which is means more than 60% of the world. United States, 1991, began to want to build high-speed railway. So far, zero. So this efficiency. So China should, I think, change our economic growth model from just eyes on the Western countries, on the value chain. We attract FDI from G7 countries, and then to be China at the world factory. Use Chinese cheap labor and resources to provide delicious food for the world. And then this is unsustainable. When the Western countries suffer the financial crisis, debt crisis, they cannot buy so much made in China. And then Chinese, made in China is, the trade, the export is reduced greatly. And the Chinese economy suffered a lot because we too much rely on their market. Now we need to discover a huge new potential market. That's OBOR countries, like Nepal. You said you are a poor country, according to the GDP. But another mean is huge potential. Like China, in the early 80s, before open reform, China also very poor. But after 30 years, we developed very rapidly. So I think we can do this. Why don't you can do this? Like cheap labor, full of resources. But the problem is the shortage of infrastructure. You don't have clean water. You don't have the oil, pipeline system, electricity, everything. So are the Chinese saying that if you got rich, build the road. If you want to get rich quickly, build the water road. If you want to get rich immediately, build the internet. Like Alibaba, e-commerce. So that's the less development. So it's a mutual benefit. For China, we benefit because of the huge market. We can sell more, we'll do more, construct more to solve China's problems. Of course, make money. The Chinese make money. But not everything make money. Some strategy program not make money. Some government program, like help building infrastructure, not make money. But discover the other make money in the long term. Western companies, because of the private, they cannot build infrastructure because this costs a lot of money long term. China, we have a strong state-owned enterprises. We can coordinate because we have NDRC, because we have a strong leadership of Communist Party. We can design a 50 years, 100 years plan. But to be frankly, your any party of you cannot do this.
That's true, yeah.
You don't know tomorrow whether you're on power or not. Communist Party, I'm sure, still in power. President Xi Jinping, I'm sure. This for after, still be the president. So our policy, strategy, consistent. Our civilization also very consistent. So that's a convince and a guarantee of these projects. Buddhism, you know, we learn from you. So today, why we still suffered by the Hiroshima, Himalaya, or other many obstacles?
Yeah.
We should build more connections. If we have the railway system, we can import oil from China and from other places. Definitely, but fundamentally change your situation.
That's right.
Like electricity. In today's world, 1.3 billion people without electricity in China. Every village, every people can access electricity. You know how many smart cell phone users of China? You know how much the sales of Alibaba in a single day? You say November 11th, a single day, the sales more than?
$12 billion,
yeah.
We often say, like, people say that Nepal is a poor country. But I say that
Nepal is
civilization rich country.
Yeah, it's not a poor country, but it's an unplanned country.
Yeah.
We have a huge financial resources. You can see these houses, but they are not constructed in a planned way. We have no idea of putting money in the industry. Instead of building these big houses everywhere, have we been able to put that money in the industry? Nepal would have been a very rich country, but we, our leadership is very weak, as you very rightly pointed out. We could not even have proper dialogue with India, but now we have adequate people to have a dialogue. So that was the last blockade. We even prepared to go to International Court of Justice eventually. So India had to suffer from a big pressure actually. So they had to withdraw unilaterally. So but people did not surrender. So that was the biggest thing. 6 months, no gas, no petrol, nothing. But people said that, okay, we will not bow down to you. And as you rightly pointed out, okay, if OBOR is not acceptable for India, and India does not want China to come with OBOR initiative, okay, then you can give.
Yeah.
But India does not have. Why India does not have something to give to Nepal? Because India's Bengal, India's Bihar, and India's Uttar Pradesh, the almost 50% of the population of India, that is the poorest part of India. They are much more poorer than us. So what India can give to us? So we have been suffering like 4.5 million people from India working. Do you know that we are the seventh remittance giving country to India?
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah.
So we were 12th 5 years before. But now we are 7th. Because they are earning a lot from Nepal. Then we earn from Nepal. So every year what we have been giving remittance to India is something like $45 billion. Why we give it is like a lot of people come here to work.
Relatives.
Yeah. No, not relatives, but Bihar is very poor. They are unemployed. So they come to, I mean, all this even here, I mean, here quarters to low-level workers they come from, like the builders and all, they come. And because they are, they work in less money than the Nepalese labor market. So they grab the work here because people, when they are constructing houses, if they make Nepalese to work, according to the law of Nepal, they need to be paid 700 minimum. 700 Nepalese rupees minimum. That means something like $10. But that is the lowest. But you cannot get Nepalese to work in even 1500 rupees. But if Indian come, they work in 500. So people give works to them, and most of the money is taken. So what our claim to India is like, you always say that you are giving to Nepal, but it's not India giving to Nepal, but Nepal is giving to you.
Mm-hmm.
It's one. Second, very, they have still Nepalese people working in their military.
Mm-hmm.
Why they engage Nepalese in military? That's not something that Nepal has benefited. The classes among the Indian states, like Maharashtra, Gujarat, Punjab, they have a military based on their ethnicity. So if there is a fight breaks, India cannot trust Marathi, India cannot trust Punjabi because they can fight each other.
Oh.
So that's the reason they have Nepalese.
So many problems is India's domestic problem.
It's a domestic
problem. They're making excuse of,
of
China and others.
Yes. I mean,
they don't have a modern dawn. They don't have the revolution to integrate the domestic, the women's power, not the, many problems, like a sad system, different classes.
We were doing a research, and what is very interesting you find is like, in 2004, out of 553 members in their parliament, 127 members were criminals. They had 10 or 12 or 15 cases in the court. In 2009, there was another election. There was a big discussion like how to get rid of these criminals in the politics, but it rose to 31% from 27%. So there was 182 members of the parliament, they were criminals. And now, in 2014, they had another election, and it rose to 34%. So there are almost 205 members who have rape cases, murder cases in the court. And you can see BJP, the President Modi's party, he has 39% of criminals. Congress has 21% of criminals. There is one called Lok Dal, that's People's Party. It has 68% criminals. And there is one called Jharkhand Mukti Mocha, Jharkhand Liberation Party. It has 100% criminals. So that's how our politics has been affected. Because they always think from the criminal perspective. Like how to grab the business in Nepal. So that's what I sometimes say that even our colleagues in China have not properly understood the problem between Nepal and China. What they always see in the service.
For that reason, we should improve our Nepal studies.
That's
also India studies.
Yes.
If we can have the overseas India study research center located in your university,
yeah.
I think that our understanding about India much better than, because our colleagues understand India only through India. The Indians just show the positive side to
that's
the to Chinese.
Right.
And then Chinese studies about India and it influence their mentality about the whole Southeast Asia.
No, that's what I've been, I mean, every time I go to China, this is my view, like last year, what is the psychology is like, we have our national dress. What do? It's like they use our national dress and our cap, and in the Hollywood cinema, in the Bollywood cinema, they project that guy as a servant, and they name Nepali, you know? So people see that film, and then they become anti-Indian. So we tell it to Indians, like, it's you are creating anti-Indian sentiment in Nepal because you do this kind of nonsense thing. You don't have you destroyed, I mean, probably they didn't do it. Probably British destroyed their culture of respect. So they go with the British legacy, that's what we say. So I was talking to JNU, and then the moderator says that we have a friend from Nepal, a small country, our young brother, from a small country, so we are very happy to have him today. And then when I started speaking, then I said, like, how many days probably it takes from Delhi to go to the southern point of India? The Ma said that, okay, it takes 2 months. And if I start walking from eastern part of Nepal, going to the western part of Nepal, it takes 6 months. Which country is bigger? So by walking, we are bigger. Because our mountain, our topography is very bad. So it's very difficult to walk. And I said, if we are younger brother, maybe we are dwarf, we are small. But in 305 BC, when there was no concept of India, there were only three countries, one Nepal, one Magad, and one Chola in the south. But our history is 3,500 years, continuous as a state. But India is India only when British came.
Yeah.
Before that, there were, I mean, 500.
And then the clear Indians in the name of the that, oh,
yeah,
in India, different Indians.
And then said, if we are brother, we are the younger, not younger brother, you are the younger.
And many Chinese don't know that Buddha's birthplace is,
yes,
is in Nepal. That's in India.
No. And I was also very angry with a couple of my Chinese friends over there. What I found is, like, I went to a very big bookshop with a friend of mine. And I got a history book, like, what is the ancient history of China and Nepal? I got a book. What it says is, like, Fayyan visited India. India was not that time. There was a Mongol. And then then another Chinese scholar, Xuan Sang, he visited India. He stayed 24 years in Nepal. Xuan Sang. He got our Buddhism to take to India. And now they say that Buddha is an Indian prince. So you go to Portala, what is written is like Buddha is an Indian prince. Where was India at that time? So these are the things. So I think our people-to-people relation, as Mr. Sharma said yesterday, should be very hectic. So lastly, before we go up, what is very interesting that we have been doing is, like, it is 13 years. We have 12th program done. It is called International Residential School on Economic, Social and Development Rights. So we talk about development. And every year we have some special topic. So this October, coming October, we're going to have the same program, 12th time. And that would be, again, China and South Asia connectivity would be the special thing. So we get 10 students from China. Most students come from Renmin,
China Communication University, Beijing, and University of Political Science and Law. So we almost have 6 students from China in here. So we have 10 students from India. We have 10 students from Bangladesh. We have 10 students from Pakistan and Sri Lanka and Nepal and Thailand. So we do discuss this. So we already have a big number of Chinese students who understand this thing. Lot of, so by the end, even Indian changed them. So that's how where I learned that. If we engage young people to discuss this, they change. So a lot of Indian, almost 100 students that participate, they support OBOR. They write, they have an alumni, okay? They almost 400 people. These two gentlemen work for that. So they almost 400 people from Nepal, Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, and China. There are 54 students from China so far, they're alumni. So we talk same. So we believe that there is a big resentment of common Indian people to their leadership. So Bihar wants to be developed. Uttar Pradesh wants to be developed. If we can pass this message, but Nepal has got some problem. Nepal has a very, very naive, very small media. So our media does not cover this message. The first time Nepal is going to have on new television where they will have a Chinese news also. So it's in Nepal, but they will give a Chinese news.
In my hotel, there are CGTN.
Yeah, but Nepal television is also going to have a Chinese program.
Cool.
That's what. We have a very poor media. Most Chinese media is probably not entertaining India. And so we don't have capacity to develop anti-China, anti-Nepal, anti-South Asia propaganda of Indian private television networks, because they don't do research. They all the time talk something unusual, like when we were having, like one very good example. There was a train from one Chinese port came to Tibet with our goods. What they said here in the media, all media from India is like, China is now building railroad and sending arms to Nepal instead of good. So in 5 years, China has a plan to invade India. So Chinese are coming to Nepal to invade India. So all television were talking like that.
Why we need to invade India?
That's the question. So this is, in my opinion, what I see is like Indian media is absolutely influenced by the Western media, Western think tank. So they encourage, instead of they talking this, so they want to, they just prepare Indian media to talk something stupid kind of things against China. But we understand that. But then we cannot challenge that because our media is very poor. So I always say China has to think building Nepal's media very strong. This would be one OBOR project. Mm-hmm. Second thing, China and Nepal have to have joint institutional cooperation. For example, research, same research. For example, I'm encouraging Renmin University. Joint research team, Kathmandu School of Law, Renmin. Let's have a lot of young people engaged in research. Publish in Chinese, publish in Nepal, publish in English. That's another. Third very important thing is like one of the reason why India is so pro-Western. Because they all go to educate themselves in the West. And their institution are applying the Western education model. So China should open more access for Nepalese young people to go and educate themselves. So they will learn Chinese, they will learn Chinese social science, they will learn Chinese way of anthropology. They will also, like we were talking about, like archaeology and all. So more Nepalese people go to China, come back. They will be the ambassador. So OBOR should also include the educational cooperation.
Amico scholarship.
Yes. So that should be bigger in number. That should be very big. And also, I mean, a lot of Nepalese can go and study on their own. Or if university will provide free education, they can pay the accommodation. Mm-hmm. So there should be some institution to encourage people to go and study in China. So we are encouraging more our students to go to do master degree in China rather than India, because we have adequate number of people who have done master degree from India. So that's how. So OBOR, I mean, my request to this very prominent delegation is that OBOR should not only be seen as an infrastructure development component. It should be considered as a very important shop to wear and the educational connectivity also. So we need to have a more professors at same, not for short time, rather a little long time, for 1 month, 2 months, develop common course, teach. So Chinese, when Chinese professor will come to Nepal, their people will be very happy, no problem. I mean, sometimes friends of mine in China say that our English is not good. It's okay, no problem. Communication is okay. I mean, even we find a lot of people to translate, that doesn't make difference.
If their English is too good, maybe they're westernized.
Yes, that's fine. That's good. Sure, with this, we can have...